Okay, welcome back. Good morning. Today is Thursday, October 28th. Almost the end of October. Almost the end of the year. Moving to 2022, which should be another intense year as they've all been in the last 5 years, 10 years, 20 years. It's another story. So today is episode 21. Life and Teachings of Nisargadatta Maharaj, reading through the 200 quotes of his teachings from the page innerquest.org. Nisargadatta Maharaj, a great Maharashtrian Jnani, means a knower of non-duality. And we left off last time at passage 79, so I'll just back up a bit and we'll start with 78. Nisargadatta said, or is translated to have said, it's all, and bear in mind that there is a non-disciplined use of the word consciousness here, because probably he himself used the word in Marathi, I guess, that was translated as consciousness, both for subjective, self-based, illusory, dualistic consciousness, awareness, as well as non-dual, transpersonal, liberated awareness. So there's sentience or awareness with subjectivity and without subjectivity. Without subjectivity is ultimately going to be freedom from all 10 fetters and real non-duality. Which is called Satchit. And then there's, in Buddhism, fifth fetter, or fifth skanda, called Vijnana. Vijnana is commonly termed consciousness, but it's subjectivist. And so that's eighth fetter, not yet broken, in Buddhism, 10 fetters. Manas, conceit, or tanamanas, craved conceit. It's really fashioned identity. The identity that is dropped, leaving sixth density, like Ross said, moving out of we become light, or all is one, or I is one, to absolute transpersonal universal awareness. And you'll see Nisargadatta talking about that a lot. However, the term, the English word consciousness, is commonly translated, Satchit is commonly translated with the word consciousness, like universal consciousness. Meanwhile, in other cases, he uses the term awareness, or the translator translated that as awareness. I think awareness is better to indicate non-subjective, trans-subjective, impersonal, transpersonal, non-dual aware, non-dual sentience or presence. Intelligent infinity is that awareness. So, 78, Nisargadatta said, it's all a matter of focus. Your mind is focused in the world. Mine is focused in reality, which is sat. It's like the moon in daylight when the sun shines. The moon is hardly visible. And so reality is ever-present, or sat-chit, awareness of reality beyond subjectivity, is ever-available. But we rarely see it because we're so fixated in nama-rupa, in the process of naming form. Name and form, naming, identifying by sankhara, samskara, fourth skanda, by fashioning, fermenting, by thought, construction, identifying catalyst or phenomena in conceptual terms, kalpana, kalpana, concept, concept, where normally the monkey mind is the very unstable mind, and the dull mind is unable to think clearly. Even the somewhat clear mind commonly is naturally automatically producing concepts all the time. It's this, it's that, I'm this, I'm that, I want, I hate, I like, I don't like. Better, worse, what now, past, present, future. all that is not sat. All that is the world of sankhara, or mental construction concept. And that's the world. The world is nama-rupa. And so the naming of form, or the establishing of naming, and this whole realm of subject-object, this whole the gestalt, that's what samsara is all about, is subject-object. And eventually, both of those are dropped. There's freedom from subjectivity, and then the world of many objects is seen as one light or one life. Yet differentiation is still possible. The mind can still do that. You know, he's talking a lot. He talks a lot. He talks a lot more than Nityananda was talking. And I talk a lot. We're all these talkers, you know. But he knows who is or what is the speaker. And he knows that talking is all relative and a dream and empty in any way. So your mind focused in the world, not just the world of apparent dimensionality, but the whole world of nama-rupa, subject-object, thinking and conceptualizing objects of the outer environment and objects in mind or mind states. His is focused in sat. Like moon in daylight, sun shines, moon hardly visible. what is truth or sat or reality beyond concept is always present, but we don't normally focus. We're rarely, if ever, focused on what's beyond concept. 79. The ordinary man is not conscious of his body as such. He's conscious of his sensations, feelings, and thoughts. Even these, once detachment sets in, move away from the center of consciousness and happen spontaneously and effortlessly. So, number one, he's saying we're normally fixated, focused consciously only on mind process about the body is recognition of sensation, and then feeling, our feelings in the body, but also what we call emotion, which I think are basically sensory thought forms or visceral thought forms, body associated thought forms, is one way of understanding emotions. You know, anger, sorrow, fear. Clearly there's thought form, concept production, and there's also viscerality or a visceral sensory experience of body. Meanwhile, the whole thing is happening in mind. The whole thing is nama, naming. And so even these, meaning sensations, feelings, and thoughts, the ordinary man conscious of mind or mind referring, even that, those objects of attention basically that's all sankhara. You know, those are all sankhara. Even these, once detachment sets in, right? What was the Marathi word original for detachment? Was it the same as vairagya, as Nityananda said? Maybe. Detachment is critical. Once detachment sets in, what is setting in? Setting in is settling in. Setting in is getting established within, or becoming established. With the establishment of true vairagya, detachment, true dispassion, what is other words for detachment, right? Non-attachment, non-attaching. The patterns, the habit of mind of non-attaching, which also means not identifying. Once that sets in, then they, the sensations, feelings, and thoughts, move away from the center of consciousness and happen spontaneously and effortlessly. And he's going to explain that in 80, or 80 is really a continuation of 79 directly, in terms of this process of spontaneously, effortlessly, spontaneous and non-will, non-personal will-based movement, flow of sensation, feeling, and thought, sankhara, moving away from a center of consciousness, which is also an idea, meaning there isn't really an outer and an inner either. That's the point. In Satchit, there is no center. So I think there was some discussion of God, the Absolute, the Source, is sort of everywhere present without a center. There is no center to omnipresence. The omniscience of omnipresence has no outer, inner, center, periphery. There's no dualism, polarity in location. There is no location for omnipresence. Therefore, there's no center nor periphery. But, which seems to us like a center, for sure. And basically move away from... The center of consciousness is another term for point of agency. I use this phrase, point of agency. Who is the self? What is a self? A self is a point of agency. Of agency of what? An agent, an apparent agent, an apparent subject, an apparent doer, or thinker, or speaker. Okay, fine. You know, none of this will be fully realized until we're out of the octave. And that's fine. And once we're back home in a higher dimension, before, for a while before we're leaving the octave, whenever that might be, this will be much more viscerally, light viscera, known by awareness. So it's fine that we're using concepts that are empty and fingers pointing to the moon and not of reality, but pointing towards reality. That's okay. So once there's a deep establishing of detachment, non-attaching, right? The mind inclines towards Nibbana, Gautama said. When that happens, then one experiences what had previously been self-identified mind process elements like sensation, feeling, and thought coming, going naturally, spontaneously, effortlessly. Crystallized healer has no will. That's the effortlessness of it. There's no will-based ownership or agency involved in that, which is actually very possible when there's great detachment, absolutely, and some recognition that I is insubstantial. I is insubstantial. That's called anatta. So once there's some penetration of anatta, some sense that the point of agency is a dream. Intelligent infinity is everywhere, nowhere. It's the uncreate. And the point of agency is the speaker. And the speaker is essentially not separate, not other than intelligent infinity, you know? So mind-body-spirit complex are vehicles. Mind-body-spirit complex, beingness, totality, complex, are accomplices. They're accomplices. They're accomplices or vehicles of the logos in the octave, which is, you know, intelligent infinity, the word made flesh. Right, the word made flesh is the logoic point of agency, the true nature of the speaker, in the vehicles of the seven chakras, seven energy fields that we may be calling mind, body, spirit, beingness, totality, complex, in the octave. So, then, 80. Lots of talk. And beyond talk, the Nisargadatta said, the center of consciousness, right, this point of agency, is that which cannot be given name and form, namarupa, for it is without quality and beyond consciousness. So the point of center of consciousness is beyond consciousness. And this is a brilliant analogy, 80 here. Like a hole in the paper is both in the paper and yet not of the paper, so is the supreme state in the very center of consciousness and yet beyond consciousness. It is as if an opening in mind through which the mind is flooded with light. It should be a capital L. The opening is not even the light, but just an opening. From mind's point of view, meaning the self-identified vijnana, manas, buddhi, pairing, it is but an opening for the light of awareness to enter the mental space. By itself, the light can only be compared to a solid, dense, rock-like, homogeneous, and changeless mass of pure awareness, free from the mental patterns of nama-rupa, name and form. This is brilliant. I mean, to me, you know, this shows his brilliance in the talent of a sage, as Chuang-tzu would say, explicating non-duality brilliantly. Not so different than Eric Dollard, D-O-L-L-A-R-D, Eric Dollard, talking about the true nature of the sun, saying that the sun is not, from his work at RCA, radio astronomy, before they threw him out because he was too honest and he was insightful. You know, that's what happens in this world. You cannot be too straight, truthful, and just and sincere in positions of, in institutions, if you wish to arise to a high level. So they threw him out. Eric Dollard, you can find his talks on YouTube, saying that the sun has no mass, that the sun is actually like an interdimensional transducer that seems to be empty space, like a hole in the galaxy, a hole in space through which something comes in and comes out as visible light and heat and energy waves and patterns of energy. So the center of consciousness, like the sun, seventh chakra, like the gateway to intelligent infinity. Open the gateway to seventh to intelligent infinity is a linkage between 6-7. In some sense, the top of the personal is six. Six chakra, six ray, six dimension. And seven is eight. The whole is not of the apparent substance or energy fields in which that whole exists. So the hole in the paper is both, quote, in the paper, but not of the paper. It isn't the paper. It's a hole. So seventh chakra, likewise, like the sun, like the center of consciousness, he's saying, like the speaker, like the agent, the point, the true point of agency, the true nature of the point of agency. The point of agency is the I, the aham. It's actually even before aham, it's the au, like aum. Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. It's the au before it became m. The au, m, aum. Before the m, it was the au. You know, aum, om, om, actually is sometimes written aum. So aum is an older transliteration of the Sanskrit om, om. Or om is a more recent dumbed down version of the earlier transliteration, or you know, I guess putting into word, putting into, I guess it's called a transliteration, Romanizing of the Vedic, you know, mantra om, om. It was earlier put as aum. Aum seems to me is a composite of au and m. It's the m of au. The M of AU is the word, is the speaking of the logos, is the word, is the logos in speech. You know, in the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. The logos, the word, was with the intelligent infinity as distinct a differentiation, and was intelligent infinity, or of the nature of intelligent infinity. Likewise, the center of consciousness, like Aum, when it's in process, when there's function occurring, when the speaker is speaking, when the word is being voiced, then we have Aum. So the voicing of Aum is Aum. The voicing of AU is AUM. The voicing of O, like zero, like void, like whole, wholeness, circle. The voicing of the whole is where we add the M, A-U and M, Aum, O and M, Aum. To me, that's the voicing of the word, the logos, the whirling cross, the logos in motion. So, meanwhile, the nature of the au, or the true point of agency, or intelligent infinity, is in its relationship to subjectivity is simply a hole. There's nothing there. What is there is an opening. So center of consciousness, and that you know, is of the condition of satchit. So satchit, we think of a thing. It's satchit. It's an awareness of reality. Sat, reality, truth. Chit, awareness. Transpersonal, non-subjective, non-dual. We think of that, I can think of that as a thing. Intelligent infinity, right? Infinite intelligence. Infinite awareness. It's not a thing. And it doesn't really have a center itself. But subjectivity, where we're calling consciousness, vijnana, as subjectivity, as ultimately a coalescence of intelligent infinity into subjective consciousness, intelligent non-infinity, finite intelligence rather than infinite intelligence, intelligent finity rather than intelligent infinity. So higher self is intelligent finity. The logos itself, in some sense, is intelligent finity, just in the sense that there's a minor differentiation from the galactic or one infinite creator. But consciousness clearly is finite and subjective. And we can say that it has a center. It doesn't really have a center, but it appears that it surely can be understood to have a center and a periphery. Meaning there's core, we can conceive of core, center, and outer periphery. And in that conceptualization, it's useful then to further recognize that at the core of the core, the center of the core, is nothing. But the nothing is not a no thing, it's a whole between the subjectivity and the universal, trans-subjective, non-subjective, non-dual. So the center of consciousness, meaning the true nature of subjectivity, can't be given name and form. It's not of Namarupa. It's not a name. You can't name it because it's not a thing, but it does not know thing either. It's not nothing, but it's also not a thing. It's not a thing that's born, arises, passing, persists, and dying, right? It's not a born, it's not death, it's not of birth, aging, sickness, and death. It's not of arising, persisting, and passing away. It's not a created form, nor can it be given a name, nor is it making a name. It doesn't make name, it doesn't perceive form, it doesn't arise, persist, and pass away. But it is not a nothing. It's the Tao, right? That from which all arises. It's intelligent infinity. It's infinite power, omniscience, omnipotence, and thus capable of omnipresence. It's without quality, it's before quality, beyond consciousness, before consciousness, beyond and before. Like a hole in the paper. It's in the paper, it appears to be of the paper, but it's not of the paper. It's not paper, it's a hole. And so the center of I is not I, but it appears to be in the center of I. It's the basis of I, which appears to be core and center. So the supreme state, which is not a state, it's the supreme reality, which we can call sat-chit. Tat-sat-chit, om tat-sat-chit, the chit of om tat-sat. In the very center of consciousness, if we talk about center and periphery, yet beyond consciousness, right? Yes, he's brilliant, you know, he's brilliant. It's as if an opening in mind through, it is as if there is, or is it is as if it is an opening in mind through which mind is flooded with light. Yeah, of course, light. Let there be light. Yes, the word made flesh. The voicing of O, Aum. The voicing of Ao is Aum. The voicing of O is Om. It gets voiced. Meaning... There is the transmission of power that comes out as light. The action, Ra said, the origin of light is the action of free will upon love. Exactly what this is. By infinite love and infinite power, infinite power acts on infinite love of intelligent infinity and generates light, which appears to come through into or is the basis of subjective consciousness, the true nature of subjective consciousness, or the center point, so-called, the center of the core of subjectivity, is nothing there. But the nothing is not a nothing, it's not a void, it's no thing, it's an opening. The opening, he said, is not even the light. Right. The opening is not the light. The opening is the whole. There's nothing there. But the nothing, again, is full. The nothing is the plenum. But just an opening. It's not even the light, but just an opening. Merely. From mind's point of view, it is but an opening for the light of awareness to enter the mental space. Meaning from here, from our side, excuse me, of this reality, from our side of this discussion, we see a hole in the roof, no roof. There's no roof. There's just the streaming light. The light of awareness, intelligent infinity, satchit, to enter the mental space, right? The difference between mind and awareness. Mind is a vehicle for the coalesced awareness called subjectivity. Beingness is the coalescence of infinity. The intelligent infinity, satchit, coalesces into subjectivity, just as I've explained before. I explain all these matters, where light turns back upon itself. The Ao, or Ao Ton, the Ton of Ao, is the M of O, of Om. It's, well, there's an expression of Ao becoming Om. There's also the turning back of that light that forms a selfhood, which is an illusory subjectivity, very persistent and very useful. It's the eighth fetter. It's ahamkara. It's so-called basis of ego. It's the sense of separative identity that is dropped when one goes beyond higher self. When one goes beyond higher self or goes from six to eight, that subjectivity is dropped, or our memory identity is dropped, as Ross said. There's the unfashioning of the fashioned. The fashioned subjectivity is defashioned, is unraveled. And that reverses the cosmogenetic process, cosmogenesis, cosmological, by which intelligent infinity coalesces by turning back upon itself, forming a subjective, separative sense of self. Intelligent infinity turns back upon itself, or actually light turns back upon itself. So intelligent infinity generates light. Light itself is, you can say it's substantial, but it's also a dream. Ross said, you're not living in a material universe, you're dancing thoughts. Well, that's vibrating dream of light. Creation is the vibratory dream of light, is the vibrating dream of Godhead fashioned of light. So too is subjectivity, is a compounded, fabricated, fermented product of light turning back upon itself, fashioning identity. And yet the center of that is nothing, is empty. The center of that is a hole. And that's, and so the life, what comes through that hole in the curtain, we're all talking about the UFO phenomenon as a hole in the curtain, the original hole is the hole in the coalesced subjectivity. The life that allows subjectivity to continue. The sense of beingness of the seven-dimensional, seven-chakra, seven-fold energy field of the octave self, the sense of self in the octave, seven-dimensional, seven-chakra, seven-energy bodies and fields. Its persistence is due to the power that comes through the whole. And so, opening for the light of awareness to enter mental space, the difference between the mind and intelligent energy. Intelligent energy is the life of mind. It's the life of mind, body, spirit. It's the life of Atman, is intelligent energy. And that came through, it came through from beyond the octave. By itself, the light can only be compared to a solid, dense, rock-like, homogeneous, changeless mass of pure awareness, right? So it's smaller than small and lighter than light and totally transparent like clear light. But he, you know, cutely, he uses the term mass of pure awareness. It's mass-like. And there is some tap in there to the experiences in samadhi when the body becomes like a rock. One feels the body motionless and very heavy. It appears to be very heavy when the light is increased in body according to higher chakra activation and deeper meditation. So, excuse me, I have a little more phlegm today, and this is phlegm stimulating to throw out the blockages. So by itself, the light can only be compared to a solid, dense, rock-like, homogeneous, changeless mass, a certain high density, right? Highest density, eighth density, mass of pure awareness, free from the mental patterns of nama rupa, name and form. Right. Before, it's this light, I'd say, you know, is certainly akin to intelligent energy, the basis of the seven rays. It's also akin to the life that allows the seven-dimensional apparent self to continue. You know, why does light vibrate? Well, light is vibratory. Why? How? Well, that's life. The life, the infinite power, omnipotence, the omnipotence, the all power of source, of intelligent infinity, of Godhead. That all power comes through as the life that keeps light vibrating. Light vibrates because of its intrinsic life. And its intrinsic life is a manifestation of the infinite power of source. All of that's way before mental patterns and mind, for sure. 81, that in which consciousness happens, that in which, I'd say, I'll read it all. That in which consciousness happens, the universal consciousness or mind, we call the ether, E-T-H-E-R, ether of consciousness. All the objects of consciousness form the universe. What is beyond both, meaning both, consciousness in the universe. What is beyond both, supporting both, is the supreme state, a state of utter stillness and silence. Whoever goes there, disappears. It is unreasonable by words or mind. You may call it God or Parabrahman, but these are names given by the mind. It is the nameless, contentless, effortless, spontaneous state beyond being or not being, beyond being or not being. As the universe is the body of the mind, so is consciousness the body of the Supreme. It is not conscious, but it gives rise to consciousness. So that in which consciousness happens. Just a second. I must turn down my... Just a moment. This is a dinner theater. I'm cooking some lamb, and or I'm about to, and my crock pot is boiling, so I must transfer. Sorry. Reality intrudes on the theoretical.
but the theoretical is real.
So, that in which consciousness happens. So I think, again, this suffers from non-strict translation that would normally differentiate the words consciousness and awareness. But it seems to me what he means is that subjective consciousness occurs within a field. And that in which this subjective consciousness happens or occurs or is, that in which it is universal consciousness or mind. Really, that is satchit. So, vijnana occurs in the field of satchit. Manas buddhi with atmanic subjectivity, I is one, occurs within the field of non-personal, non-dual satchit, which you can call mind, but you know you get into trouble when you use the word mind for satchit or chit. We call the ether of consciousness, okay, we can call it that. Ether, very similar to six chakra, six energy field, the etheric body. Yeah, intelligent energy. So intelligent energy actually is above the seven rays, but it comes in six ray, or six chakra. So there's a very strange matter to that, that prior to seven was the three, but the three, you know, free will, love, light, that gave rise to light, is really a two that gave rise to light, making a three, but Ra saying that the seven rays or colors, vibratory frequencies, came out of intelligent energy, light with a capital L, intelligent energy, comes in by six chakra. But if seven chakra is the highest, why is it coming in below? Well, seven chakra isn't personal. There is no seven chakra. Seven chakra is a whole. Like a hole in the sky, the center of consciousness, it seems to me. Anyway, he's saying that, I think he's saying that subjective dualistic consciousness happens or is occurring in a field of universal awareness, which could be called an ether of consciousness, and it's very much associated with intelligent energy, indeed, which is called the etheric body in the raw material, or etheric energy. All the objects of consciousness form the universe. So what is the universe is called the octave, seven dimensions, so-called, wherein there is nama-rupa, or a subjectivity naming objects. You know, time and space, time is of mind and subjectivity, space is of apparent objects or rupa. These objects of consciousness, which is the realm of nama-rupa, form what we call the universe, which is basically the dimensional, you know, the multidimensionality of the octave. What's beyond the octave, what's beyond both, beyond objects of consciousness, beyond the universe, beyond consciousness itself, supporting both, is the supreme state, a state of utter stillness and silence. You see, it's not a state, because it doesn't arise and pass away. It's the non-state. States of consciousness, even higher jhana states of consciousness, right? Perception of infinity of space, infinity of consciousness, perception of nothingness, neither perception or non-perception. Those are called states. They're anicca, anatta, dukkha. They're impermanent, insubstantial, temporary. They come and go. And dukkha thereby, or stressful in some sense. Those are states. You can't even say what's beyond consciousness, what's beyond namarupa, what's beyond subjectivity, what's beyond dimensionality, is a state. It's not a supreme state, it's the supreme. And so you can say that it's sat-chit, the chit of sat. It's actually sat, be without any chat, without any chit, because there's, you know, intelligent, in the one infinite creator is actually a nice way of putting it. Intelligent infinity is infinity. And infinity, or the primal, the causeless cause, the causeless, you know, doer, the agent of the one actor of creation, the creation, the true nature of the creation, as the creator, who manifests its dream as creation, is all, and that has attributes, we can say, but it's beyond attribute, and so it's not a state, even. But we have to use words, and translators are not, you know, yanis. So what's beyond both, beyond the apparent universe, beyond objects of consciousness or rupa or the sphere, the realm of subject-object, is a supreme, could be called a supreme state, is the supreme. It's not a state, but therein is utter stillness and silence. And that's why, you know, a quiet mind is the path back to the unmoving source. Whatever goes there disappears. Yeah, it's like a good firewall. It's unreasonable by words or mind. You can't reason with it. It's unreasonable. God is so unreasonable. You may call it God or Paraparaman, Parabrahman, the greater Brahman, beyond the beyond Brahman. But these are names, of course, given by mind, of course. It is nameless, contentless, effortless, right? A crystallized healer has no will. And he talks about this a lot, about, you know, phenomena arise and pass naturally. All is done by God, the one doer. Therefore, you know, like Ross said, he, Nisargadatta, or any yani, really, has no will, or is beyond personal willfulness. And therefore, there's effortless, spontaneous. It's effortless, spontaneous state beyond being or not being. So it's not state, actually. It is the nameless. It is nameless, contentless, effortless, and spontaneous beyond being or not being. It wasn't created, so it can be destroyed. It's not a thing, so it cannot be called being. As the universe, or as the basis of created universe, it's the body of the mind. Ooh. As, and he's actually saying, as the universe, this is a different way of saying it, as the universe, meaning the apparent environment of dimensionalities and forms and objects, right? Galaxies and stars and planets and bodies and dimensions and, you know, mineral elements and minerals and plants and animals and humans and higher dimensional devas and asuras. Those things of the universe can be understood as the body of the mind, the body of Godhead also. So too, then, he would say, or he's saying, consciousness is the body of the Supreme. And so there's physical, there's, you know, form, name and form. The light, when pranava comes out, and au becomes om with an M, the voicing or expression of the logos into word, into light, giving rise to the seven rays, seven dimensions, octaves, and all that, and all the forms of the created universe. That can be called the body of our mind. It's a manifestation of the personal mind's sense of form. The personal mind conceives form. The outer is the conception of the mind's making. Or our experience of it cannot be other than our relation to our own conceiving of the outer. So too, or so is consciousness the body of the Supreme. And so the human mind conceives the outer environment of rupa by nama. So we do nama rupa. And that, I think, is related to him saying the universe or the apparent created worlds can be thought of as a body to the mind, the formal basis of mind, human mind, personal mind, you know, subjective mind. So too, then, can be consciousness, the other, you know, the other manifestation of energy, right? Light manifests as, or light manifests as energy, and light manifests as consciousness. As energy, we end up eventually energy becomes matter and form. So E equals MC squared, right? So said one of those fellows, the plagiarist, but he probably got that from someone else, you know. So light and, or energy and matter are interconvertible because matter is a form of energy. Energy itself is a form of light with a capital L, intelligent energy. Love, light, love, pneuma, prana. So pneuma for the Greek, prana for the Hindu yogi. Light, the raw material, intelligent energy, gives rise to energy that manifests as both form, objects, matter, as well as coalescing into consciousness, subjective consciousness. So that that coalescing of light into subjective consciousness can be seen as the body of the Supreme. So the Supreme, you know, here again is Parabrahman or God or intelligent infinity. Of the quality, if we differentiate, of infinite awareness, satchit. So infinite awareness, intelligent infinity, infinite awareness, satchit, is the, you know, awareness basis that gives rise to subjectivity in the octave, which could be called its body. So the body of the Supreme, the body of Godhead, of intelligent infinity, Godhead of intelligent infinity or infinite intelligence, coalesces light down to consciousness. It's not conscious, but it gives rise to consciousness. Now is what? It's what's beyond consciousness, subjective consciousness, and beyond objects of consciousness. So there's nama rupa, where rupa are objects of consciousness, and nama is the action of consciousness, right? Consciousness does nama, naming, conceptualizing, sankhara, of rupa, the rupa of physical objects, material form, and mental objects and mental states, and all sorts of other things, anything. The mind conceives the apparently real forms of matter and mind itself. That mind is of subjective consciousness, a coalescence of light, and it's could be seen, he's saying here, as the body, the form of a form manifestation of intelligent awareness, infinite awareness, intelligent infinity, infinite intelligence. It's not conscious, but it gives rise to consciousness, right? So satchit, infinite awareness, is not consciousness. It's not subjective. It's not a being or a non-being, but it gives rise to those that are of being and non-being. If you're still around. 4806-82, Nisargadatta said, I am telling you from experience that the Supreme is neither conscious nor unconscious. Quote, knowing absolute reality is the supreme knowledge. Prajñanam Brahma. Prajñanam is consciousness as the essence of the self, capital S, the energy source that's prior to everything. So prajñanam, the nam of prajña, or the summit of wisdom, knowledge, is consciousness as the essence of the self. So the essence of the self, you know, I don't even know why self would need to be brought in here, but prajñanam is consciousness as the essence of the self, the universal self, the energy source that is prior to everything, prajñanam. Everything is a form of energy. Consciousness is most differentiated in the waking state, less so in dream, still less in deep sleep, meaning dreamless sleep. Homogeneous in the fourth state, turiya. Turiya, I think, is dreamless sleep. Beyond is the inexpressible monolithic reality, the abode of the Yani. This seems to be a patched together quote. So he has experience that the Supreme is not conscious or unconscious. It's not a state of consciousness with a subjective being with presuming a subjective being, meaning there's not an experience of me, but there's also not an experience of nothing, unconscious, or what, whacked mind, no mind. Knowing, quote, this is like some quote from somewhere, knowing absolute reality, so absolute reality is sat. So sat vid is the vid of sat. The vid is knowledge, sat absolute reality. So you can say sat vid is supreme knowledge, paravid. Sat vid is param vid, prajñanam brahma. Brahma as Godhead or supreme. You know, to call God the supreme guy, like Brahma, a god, with a capital G, the only one, seems superfluous, but, you know, some people are trying to work out of that. So, Satvid is supreme knowledge. So, knowing Sat is Satvid, which can also be called prajñanam brahma, the prajña of Brahma. Now, prajñanam, this wisdom of the supreme, the knowing of what's, you know, beyond consciousness and subjectivity, is, he says, is consciousness as essence of self. So the essence of what I is, which is really the au, you know, the au, the I, the you know, the point of agency, although it's not a point, the speaker, the one that speaks, this one here, as Nityananda would say, this one here, and I would say the speaker, meaning the one that speaks, is akin, you know, like let there be light, God that issues light, logos, being with God, being God, being of a manifestation of infinity, issuing light out of this union of will and love, infinite action of free will upon love. This knowledge of reality is the essence of self, or the yani, he would say. Again, I don't know why even self needs to be brought up there. The energy source prior to everything, and so then you have intelligent energy prior to the seven rays, but you have absolute power prior to light. Everything's a form of energy. So Ra said the nature of all energy is light. So again, energy used by Ra as a differentiation of light, which is intelligent energy, or love, light, love. This result of, you know, the speaking forth of Aul, or the issuing of light from, you know, intelligent infinity itself. Everything's a form of energy. Consciousness is most differentiated, and then we have this rundown of differentiations of consciousness in the various states. Waking, most differentiated. And so that's one reason that it's actually kind of useful to have the eyes half open in meditation, because it counteracts this notion, presumption, that absolute awakening is separate from the visual field. The visual field, the phenomenal appearance that I may see with my eyes, and then the apparent rupa that I may be nama, that I may name, the apparent outer environment that I may be conceiving, conceptualizing, naming, talking about, thinking about, is not separate from absolute reality. You don't have to close your eyes to get it. That kind of thing. And so consciousness is most differentiated in the waking state, yes. But keeping the eyes half open in meditation doesn't have to lead to thinking about what is being half seen. When the eyes are half open, you're sort of half seeing the floor in front of you. Now, you could be thinking about it, but you don't have to. And one can be seeing with the eyes without thinking. Although one needs a certain kind of pranic flow for that, a certain stillness of mind. So one can be seeing without thinking, not generating sankhara, but the visual, the eye door is open. So that kind of counteracts the I think, sort of immature presumption that you got to close your eyes to get to a high state, open your eyes and you're back down here. That's the normal way we think, but it's not, it's a distortion or a mistake. Opening eyes, closed eyes, actually is irrelevant to the attainment of many high states. Not all, I would imagine. I haven't attained them all, so I don't know. But some states, certainly of samadhi, of quiet mind, of freedom from proliferation, can coexist with the eyes open. One can see without thinking. But of course, then one doesn't know one's seeing. One doesn't know what one's seeing, or if one is seeing, or even if there is a one who is seeing, when the mind's really quiet. Anyway, 83. God is the all-doer. The yani is the non-doer. God himself does not say, I am doing all. To him, to God, things happen by their own nature. However, the logoi do make adjustments. To the yani, all's done by God. He sees no difference between God and nature, nisarga. Both God and yani know themselves to be the immovable center of the movable, the eternal witness, a point of pure awareness. They know themselves to be as nothing, therefore nothing can resist them. It sounds a little bit Taoist, like, you know, the Tao is formless and seeks nothing, therefore nothing can resist it. Something like that. The problem, there doesn't seem to be a problem to you, but there seems to be a little problem to me. If you think of yourself as an immovable center of the movable, an eternal witness, point of awareness as a point. If you think of yourself as a point, you're attached to a certain state of a certain differentiation in a certain kind of apparently non-dual identity. It's a kind of spiritual inflation, a kind of mistaken reification. A reification is mistaken in any way. A reification that is mistaken, that concretizes transpersonal awareness, that transpersonalizes the reality of Satchit. Satchit, it doesn't have a point nor a periphery. The Godhead, the absolute Prajnanam Brahma, has no center nor periphery. And now, while we're in the body, we obviously have a center, and that's because there's still this the coalescence of infinite intelligence to the extent that we're finished with evolution. Whatever, whether we are or not, is still naturally body identified, and thus takes physical form, physical body as a center point for consciousness. To whatever extent that consciousness is purified into non-subjective awareness, we still have this body. There's still this body. Gautama called it, for those that are finished, nirvana with remainder. The remainder was the fact of continued incarnation, and the body that was a karmic remainder for past activity, past lives, that gave rise to this incarnation. The incarnation's over, not yet over. The remainder remains. It's remaining. After the incarnation, there's nirvan without remainder. The remainder's gone. Nothing remains. So while we're here, even for a yani, I'd imagine, it's inevitable that the mind thinks in terms of center point or point of agency, inner, outer, center point and periphery. But actually, Satchit doesn't have center point nor periphery. Meanwhile, once you have once Ao becomes voiced, and the light is let there be, is allowed to be, light is fashioned by intelligent infinity and emitted, and we have galaxies and stars and all that, plus obviously octaves and dimensions, seven rays manifesting light. when that comes up, then we have these notions and experience of center point and periphery. But it's the remainder of that think that the creation of polarity, polarized light, where we have mind nama rupa, where we have light coalesced as subjective consciousness and light coalesced as energy fields that come down as matter and rupa. You know, it's the same intelligent energy or light that is the basis of matter and consciousness. That's what he's saying. That's very true. It's very profound teaching. Profound teaching. So that light is the basis of creation, seven rays, and thus the basis of both consciousness and matter, energy, and form. So the environmental phenomenal, the subjective phenomenal, namarupa, name and form, an apparent center point of consciousness or subjectivity called me, aham, but particularly it's the aham karam, the fashioned identity, which is a coalescence of light, and then energy fields, which themselves are or seven rays, you know, which are a form of a coalescence or manifestation of light itself into energy and then matter form, rupa. So to say both God and Yani know themselves to be the immovable center of the movable eternal witness, a point of pure awareness, I think it's not quite that way, because when there is a distinction between movable, immovable, or a witness that does a function, then you can talk this way. But actually, the Logoi, as far as I could imagine, don't really have awareness of the polarity of movable, immovable, nor center point and environment periphery. So eternal witness, point of pure awareness, yeah. And that point of pure awareness, Satchit, would be beyond experiential, perceptual polarity of immovable, movable as well, actually, and center point periphery. They know themselves to be as nothing. Therefore, nothing can resist them. It's not a no thing, of course. It's the source of light that is the source of all things. So, you know, talking about this can only take us so far. So, and here I will finish with 84. Nisargadat said, being nothing, I am all. Everything is me. Everything is mine. Just as my body moves by mere thinking of the movement, so do things happen as I think of them. Mind you, I do nothing. I just see them happen. I accept, and I am accepted. I am nothing, and nothing is not afraid of nothing. So being nothing, you know, being understanding I as not a thing, understanding I as boundless awareness means that I knows it's all. Like Ross said, we no longer seek light, we become light. So I am all means this I and the apparent other outer of the all is one. Everything is me, everything is mine. So this, you know, this looks a little bit Atmanic rather than eighth density. But who knows? You know, what the hell do I know? It's all, you know, translators have issues, and words are faulty, and it's inevitable. Even, you know, supreme great teachers commonly don't always use every word in a disciplined, systematic, rigorous way, because they're not scholars. They're, you know, initiators. So it's hard to criticize. One shouldn't be too heavy with the criticism. Me too. Everything is me. Everything is mine. You know, all is of the one, which is not separate from this I. just as my, I mean, I don't like to hear all this I and my, but, you know, whatever. Just as my body moves by mere thinking of movement, the autonomicity of body-mind for the yoni, free from personal willfulness. Just as body moves by mere thinking of movement, so do things happen as I think of them. Mind you, I do nothing. You know, I don't like to hear too much talk of I and mind because it looks like spiritual inflation. And it definitely, you know, fuels the fire of those that are prone to spiritual inflation. And everyone is to some degree until they're finished with Atman. And, you know, I'm not saying he has any spiritual inflation. I don't know. I just don't like too much talk of I, because I don't think of it like that. So, mind you, I do nothing. I just see them happen as this sort of center point awareness. I accept and I am accepted. I am nothing, and nothing is not afraid of nothing. Nobody. Exebache, speaking to William Blake, the dead man, said, I am nobody. So, nobody, like the yoni free of subjectivity, can say I am no thing. It doesn't mean I am not, it means I'm not a thing. Really, I is not a thing. Properly, one should write it as I is not a thing. Aham or au is not a thing. And nothing is not afraid of nothing. So, what I is not afraid of what I is. So he has no fear. So that, you know, and that is a sign of sign of the end of the path. At the end of the path, the final blockages of the lower triad are removed or released. And ultimately, like I said, that passes through annihilatory dread, releases that. And that is sort of the deepest level of mind surrendering the instinct to protect the illusory separative self. The illusory separative self naturally generates fear because there's the presumption of a field that needs protection, thus is prone to fear. At deepest level, annihilatory fear, dread. When that's finished, when one's finished with that, then it's over. The game's over. And that, in Buddhism, that's called smashing the bottom of the bucket, it seems to me. And at that point, there's no seven chakra column. There's just, you know, this form arrayed upon an apparent column of seven centers and points of light, bursts, explodes, and becomes the one light field, and that's the end of the game. And one joins the ranks of the beloved guardians who stand tall, always. So, and that'll be it for today. And next time we'll pick up at 85. So, I hope this is well. 108.18. And take good care of yourselves. See you next time, and good night.